Welcome to the Social Business Engine Podcast,
where today's thought leaders discuss how they're using the latest social media strategies and technologies in marketing, sales, customer service, and HR. Get ready to be inspired as our guests contribute to your digital transformation through their stories, knowledge, and insights into what works in today's digitally connected world. And now, here's Bernie Borges, your host of the Social Business Engine Podcast.
Hey there, welcome to episode 205. I'm Bernie Borges, CMO of Ingresso, and your host of the Social Business Engine Podcast. Hey, thanks for listening. Hey, on this episode, you are going to meet Duncan Wardle. Duncan spent 30 years at arguably the best-known brand in the world. In his last role, he was a global executive in charge of something that most companies don't even identify as a function in the business. That function is innovation. Duncan was vice president of innovation and creativity. His job was to invent new ways to generate revenue. No pressure, right? You know, we think of innovation as something that companies just do, but in reality, it's the people in those companies who innovate. The problem is that most people in today's day and age aren't given the time or the tools to innovate. So after 30 years in a global corporate brand, the best known brand in the world, Duncan now has his own company, and it's called Ideate and Innovate. And the 8 is spelled, by the way, with the number 8. And he travels the globe helping companies, many of which are household brand names, overcome the challenges that are associated with innovating. After all, if you look at a company like Blockbuster, the price they paid for not innovating was handing over the entire movie rental industry to an innovator we all know called Netflix. Now, I don't want to steal too much thunder from Duncan, but here's what you're going to hear on this episode. You're going to hear about 4 tools that he teaches brands to foster creativity in order to innovate. And at the end of this episode, I asked Duncan for one thing that B2B brands should do to innovate. And the reason that I asked him this question is because his corporate career was at Disney, arguably the most famous brand in the world, but not a B2B company. And as you're going to hear, these 4 tools to innovate are applicable everywhere, whether you're B2C, B2B, nonprofit, it just doesn't matter. These are universal principles. So by now, you're probably thinking, all right, well, let's get to Duncan, and I don't blame you. But first, I need to pay the bills, and I need to let you know that this episode is sponsored by SAP. Social Business Journal Volume 11 is a case study in savvy social selling the SAP way. That's the name of the journal. This case study is available for download without a form to fill. That means it's ungated. All you have to do is click on the big button and open the PDF right there in your browser. And you can get it at vengresso.com/SAP. And of course, you know that we're going to link that up in our show notes page at vengresso.com. All right. And now, finally, here's my conversation with Duncan Wardle. Well, Duncan, welcome to the Social Business Engine Podcast.
Thank you for having me.
Absolutely. Well, I want to set the stage before we get into our conversation, because this episode is going to be a little bit of a departure from kind of my typical podcast here in the Social Business Engine. First of all, I had the pleasure of meeting you at Social Media Marketing World in San Diego, where you delivered an hour and a half long presentation / workshop. I think your workshops were probably longer than an hour and a half. And I was the guy that was responsible for introducing you and then booting you off stage when your time was up. And I hated doing that. And so did the 500 people in the audience. Hated giving up that time with you. You blew everybody away, Duncan, including myself. And what I want, the reason I invited you on the podcast is to introduce my listener to the concepts that you are out there teaching globally to companies across all industries, of course, not limited to B2B, but since most of my listeners are B2B, I really want to inspire them around the principles that you teach companies around innovation and creativity. So why don't we begin with your story, Duncan? Tell your story, how you got to where you are today.
Started at Disney 30 years ago. I was a barman at the Rosencrown Pub at Epcot. At the end of the year, I went back to London, and I think my best prospects at the time were local barman or postman. And I called the Disney office in London. I only had 6 people in it at the time. It now has 2,000. I called every day for 27 days until the assistant got fed up of taking my phone calls. And she gave me an interview with the head of the Disney London office at the time. And I got a job. I was the coffee boy for Disney 30 years ago. I worked my way through the ranks. I started in PR, opened Disneyland Paris in 92, Cruise Lines and Animal Kingdom 98. I can't remember what else. I've opened a park in Tokyo. I've opened a park in Hong Kong and Shanghai. And about 6 years ago, I got a call. I was head of global public relations for Disney. And I got a call from the chairman. And it's never good, is it, when you get the call from the chairman? They're never phoning up to say, hey, I think you're doing a great job. He said, you're the guy with all the big ideas. You're in charge of innovation and creativity. To which my exact response was, what the hell is that? And so classic chairman response, go figure it out. So
I want to be clear. He said, you're in charge of innovation and creativity. Those were your marching orders?
That was as much direction as I got. And then it was go figure it out. And I suppose the part of that part B of the brief was, I want you to increase our capacity to innovate across all our lines of business. So that was the brief. And so I went away and I surveyed 5,000 people at Lucasfilms, Marvel, Pixar, Disney Parks, Imagineering, ABC, ESPN. What were the barriers to being more innovative and creative? None of which I think will be as a huge surprise to your audience. But the big 5 were time or lack thereof. And you hear people say, I don't have time to think. We didn't have a common definition around innovation and creativity. Everybody had a different definition. We were a risk-averse organization. Nobody gave us the tools to take smart risks. Consumer insight was being underused. We're very product-centric. We build it, they will come organization. And we needed to turn ourselves into being much more consumer-centric. And ideas got stuck, diluted, or killed as they move through the organization. So that was sort of part one. Those were the 5 themes. I went on a number of workshops and courses around innovation and creativity, the sorts that you go to conferences on. And you find that when you leave these conferences and you've listened to 8 speakers in a day, you want to put your cape on, you've got your superhero badge on, you fly out the window, you're going to change the world, you've listened to it, you're so inspired and motivated. And here's what happened. When you get back to the office, about a week later, somebody says, so, Duncan, how was that course in New York? And you sort of blank look up over your face and you say, well, it was great, but you can't remember anything and you haven't learned anything and you haven't used anything. And I said to our boss, I said, look, we can't keep hiring in people that just give inspirational and motivation. We have to create our own design thinking toolkit that we can use to innovate, that normal people who didn't necessarily go to MIT or Stanford, but they can all think differently. Took me about a year to build. And then I ran a number of innovations.
To build what? What is it?
Oh, so an innovation toolkit. And what I mean by this is tangible tools that people could use tomorrow morning at 9 o'clock to think creatively and innovatively. And I'll give you the example as to why people need to do this.
And you're going to give us examples of some of those tangible tools that my listeners can take away.
Yep, okay. Absolutely. So number one is we've been told since the day we left school, we're not creative. And at some point in our lives, we end up believing it, which is nonsense because we were all children once. The other thing, and probably the biggest barrier for most of us when it comes to innovation, is our own experience and our own expertise. Because after 15, 20, 25 years in the same role or series of roles, you build up an enormous amount of expertise and experience that allows you to make decisions really quickly, really fast. And for 95% of your job, that's why you're employed. But for the other 5%, which is becoming increasingly important in all of our jobs now, with the artificial intelligence and everything else, we're being told, I need you to think different. And thinking differently for most of us is really hard because our own experience and expertise shuts down thousands of ideas because we know thousands of reasons why they may not work. And so I designed 4 lateral thinking tools and an innovation toolkit to get you out of your river of thinking and thinking differently. So, for example, the very first one was actually created by Walt back in 1940. Walt Disney.
I've heard of him. Yeah, okay.
So, yeah, right, fairly creative and innovative chap, as I recall. He was showing Fantasia in the movie theaters in 1940, and he noticed that it was pretty dark and dingy inside the movie theaters, and he wanted to control the environment. So he used a tool called What If. The first thing you do is list all the rules of your challenge, and he listed cinemas were dark, dirty, couldn't control the environment, you had to go to a set time, you had to sit in a set chair, you had to watch the previews, etc. And so you list the rules of your challenge as quickly as you can, and then you take one of those rules and say, what if that rule didn't exist? And he chose, I can't control the environment. And he said, what if I could? Which was a bizarre statement in 1940 because he didn't own any of the movie theaters. But then he said, okay, now imagine a world where I might. Okay, well, if I don't own the movie theaters, I can't control the environment inside. Well, what if I take my movies outside? Well, if I took my movies outside, they can't be two-dimensional anymore because I don't have any screens and they'd fall over and people wouldn't be able to see them. Well, in order for people to see them, then I'd have to make them three-dimensional. Well, if I make them three-dimensional, the characters would have to have lands to live in so people would be immersed in the stories. The princesses couldn't live next to the pirates. They'd have to have different, oh, I know, I'll call it Disneyland. bang. That's innovation, not iteration. Another example that I'll share with you, which is probably more familiar with everybody, is all of us used to go to Blockbusters. And the founder of Netflix listed all the rules of going to Blockbusters. He said, okay, I have to Be Kind and Rewind. I have to drive to a physical store. They've only got a limited stock on opening day. I have to go during opening hours. I have to have a membership card. I have to pay late fees. And he took late fees. And he said, what if there were no late fees? He took physical store. And he said, what if there was no physical store? Well, that was an outrageous what if 10 years ago. And he said, well, wait a minute. Imagine a world where I could actually make it work. Well, YouTube already exists. They've been streaming content for years. They've just been streaming amateur content. I'm going to stream this content from the studios. I'm going to create a streaming service where nobody would have to drive to a physical store. Nobody would have to Be Kind and Rewind. Nobody would need a membership card. Nobody would get a late fee because I'll cut the rental off after 24 hours. And they can rent them at whatever time of day they like. I'll call it Netflix. Another smaller example, because I think some people say, oh, Netflix and Disney, that's too big. I'll never be able to do that. Anybody can use this tool. Step one, list the rules of your challenge as quickly as you can. Step two, take one of those rules and ask the absurd what if question. And step three, land a world where it could actually happen. There was a very small factory in Nottingham in England that used to make glasses that we drink out of. And they listed all the rules of the glasses going out. They noticed they had lots of breakages and the production wasn't as fast as they wanted. So they went down to the factory floor, observed everybody wrapping the glasses, and wrote down all the rules of the glasses as they were being packed. The conveyor belt, the amount of employees, the packaging, the paper. They were packaging a newspaper. They're packing a newspaper because newspaper was free and it's also very good at packing glass. They also wrote down the employees were reading the newspaper and therefore they had lots of breakages and the production wasn't as quick as they want. And somebody immediately asked the provocative what if. And the more provocative your what if, you're not going to do this what if, is to provoke you to get out of your river of thinking and think differently. Somebody said, what if we poke their eyes out? Well, clearly, that's not particularly polite, and it's not very nice, and it's against the law. But if he hadn't said, what if we poke their eyes out, the lady next to him said, oh, wait a minute, let's hire blind people. And they did. They hired blind people. Their production went up 12%. Breakage went down 8%. They got a 50% subsidy salary from the British government for hiring people with disabilities. So the tool works. So we just did a project not so long ago at Disney. We listed all the rules of coming to a Disney theme park. It's hot. It's humid. I have to stand in line. Have to buy a ticket, have to meet a character, etc. And we said, we took stand in line and we said, what if you didn't have to stand in line? Which was an absurd suggestion 8 years ago. And we said, well, wait a minute. What if you didn't stand in line for the front desk to our hotels, the entrance to our parks, for your favorite attractions or character meet and greets or merchandise or food? Fast forward, we looked at RFID technology and realized that if we gave somebody an RFID band 3 months before they arrived, they could reserve their favorite attractions online. That would be sent to their RFID band. That band is now their room key. They don't stand in line to check in anymore. They don't stand in line to get into our park. They walk straight up to their favorite attractions and character meet and greets with the reservations. For merchandise, they tap once, it goes to their hotel room. You tap it twice, it goes to your house. For fast food, I save my fast food on my phone. And when I walk into the restaurant knows I'm there. I touch table 47, food comes fresh to me. Now, had we, and this is the advice I would give to many, many people, we're all driven and measured by quarterly results.
Now, before you go there, Duncan, I want to come back to the four thinking tools because I've got three so far, listing the rules and then asking, you know, what if?
If you don't have a why and a purpose as to why you exist, whether you're B2B or B2C, you know, what's your purpose? What do you stand for? So instead of saying, how might we make more money? We took the biggest consumer pain point, which again, in the B2B industry, your consumers are still other business providers. And you might say, what's the biggest pain point my business provider suffers from? Well, for us, our consumers in the park were, they said, I don't want to stand in line anymore. So we said, well, what if there were no lines, which was an absurd suggestion. And what resulted in those RFID bands, the average guest now has 2 hours free time a day. What do guests do with free time? They spend money. Been the biggest incremental revenue driver of anything we've put into a Disney park in the last decade. And now, in terms of big data, everybody's talking about big data. Guests are telling us every second and every minute of every day what they like and what they don't like by where they go and what they see. And so, for example, we would know now how many people are coming through the front gate between 8 a.m. and 11 a.m. So instead of hiring Johnny to work at the front gate 8 hours a day, I now know by 11 a.m. the peak of people coming into the park has passed. So I can move Johnny to a parade operational route in the middle of the afternoon or fireworks in the evening. Johnny now has three jobs in 8 hours versus one, which makes his job satisfaction much stronger. And I get to reduce some of my labor costs. So actually, by starting with the key point, whether you're B2B or B2C, is start with your end user and ask what's their biggest pain point rather than how might I make more money out of them.
That makes great sense. So I actually want to give a shout out to a B2B brand and how they have reinvented themselves through some innovation. Let's do that. But first, I want to pause briefly for a message from our sponsor. SAP has trained 12,000 sales reps across the globe in social selling strategies. SAP sales reps are skilled at identifying buying signals in social media, engaging prospects in sales conversations, differentiating themselves from competition, and leveraging a technology-driven sales process. The result is sales reps at SAP who use social selling practices have more than 5 times bigger deals on average than those who don't. To learn how SAP has implemented and maintains their global social selling program and what's next on this, get the case study in Social Business Journal, Volume 11. It's available for download without a form to fill out at vengresso.com/SAP. That's Savvy Social Selling, the SAP Way, available for download ungated at vengresso.com/SAP. Duncan, there's a company that we're all familiar with. Once upon a time, most of us had a BlackBerry phone, but few people have one. I'm not even sure that they're still available. Most of us have an Android or an iOS phone these days. But once upon a time, that was the market leader in phones. Well, today, that company that used to be called Research in Motion is actually now branded BlackBerry, but they're in a different business. They're in the business of enterprise security software. So whether or not you know specifically how they reinvented, I'd like for you to comment, how does a company go through that process of innovating? And in their case, they reinvented their business and they are a B2B company. What's that process look like?
Well, I think it starts, I'm going to start with their end user again, whoever their end user are. So again, B2B or B2C, it's about this. Everybody's talking about design thinking. And we go, oh, what's design thinking? I like to break things down to absolute simple things. Design thinking means create and build something your consumer has shown you they want or need, not what you think they might want or need. And so, for example, I did some work for Stanley Black & Decker not so long ago. They asked me to come in and help them think about different lines of business. And I said, I don't know anything about the tool industry. And so I thought, God, what shall I do? So I went down to Home Depot and Lowe's and hung out in the aisles like some creepy guy. And I just listened to their consumers at the point of purchase. And at the point of purchase, and I went back to report to Stanley, I said, look, my father cared that you're called Stanley, but my father passed away many years ago. I sort of care that you're called Stanley, but you know what? The generation that's coming behind me, they don't care who you are, how much you are, or what color you are. They care for what's your why, what's your purpose. And so what I noticed was nobody was talking about the hammer or the chisel or the price point. What they were actually talking about together very excitedly was building their dream living room, their dream kitchen, or their dream bathroom. And so I went back to Stanley and I said, listen, your point of differentiation here is not your brand per se or your price point. You are the brand that helps people build their dreams. Now, if you're the brand that helps people build their dreams, you can now get out of Home Depot and Lowe's. What else could you offer as a brand who helps people build their dreams? What other industries and lines of business could you get into? The reason I suggested it was because we were just talking about before we came on air here, you know, they're now printing 3D houses in Texas. Well, if you can print houses in 3D and coffee tables and desks and chairs and lamps, what do you use a tool for 5 years from now? So I think industries that are, you know, I think BlackBerry did a superb job, but they were already under threat. But they have done a superb job of looking for other industries and lines of business where they could be. But I think companies need to do it. The one thing that Disney was extremely good at was it's even when it was right at the top of its business, it was always looking out for what's the next innovation? How will we continue to survive in the future? And it's about looking out for your business and looking into the future. People are so obsessed with quarterly results at the moment, and Wall Street is demanding that, but nobody's got a long-term vision. And quarterly results will get you into the next 3 or 4 years. They will not make you survive as a brand.
Yep. So what about the actual process? One of the things that I remember vividly from the session that you delivered at Social Media Marketing World, you asked the audience by show of hands and volunteering their input, like where they have their most creative thinking. And there were a dozen or so responses. And this was very real time, you know, and I don't think you had any plants in the audience, Duncan. Very spontaneous, not one answer, not a single answer was at work. Would you comment on that, please?
Yeah, I'd be delighted to. So if I were to ask your audience sitting here listening now to pause, close your eyes and ask yourself the following question. Where are you and what are you doing usually when you get your best ideas? And what you hear people say are popping into their head is shower, walking the dog, running, commuting, playing with the children, staring at the wall. You never hear anybody say at work. And you're like, well, why? Well, because being at work is the same as being in an argument. And if you've ever been in a verbal argument with somebody and you're defending yourself, you get really angry, you get really stressed out, then you walk away from that argument. 5 or 10 minutes later, you're sitting down, you're having a cup of coffee, and you're just sitting there and you're relaxed. And suddenly, what just pops into your head? The killer one-liner, that one line that you wish you'd used during the argument, because, oh my God, if I'd have said that, I'd have totally landed it. I'd have killed the argument. And it's really frustrating because for most of us anyway, that killer one-liner never comes up during the argument. It always comes 5 minutes later. Why? Because being in an argument is the same as being in the office. You're in what I call busy beta. Your brain is very stressed. You're doing presentations, you're typing, you're scheduling a meeting, and you hear yourself say, I don't have time to think. And when we don't have time to think, you can't come up with that killer one-liner in the argument. You can't come up with that big idea. And people, you know, I'm not asking people to be playful every minute of every day. But when you're playful, your brain relaxes. And the door between your conscious and subconscious brain opens metaphorically. And it places you back in the shower, walking the dog, just about to fall asleep. And that's where people get a lot of their big ideas. And so when you're in an ideation session and people get forced with a deadline, we must have a big idea by 5 o'clock this afternoon. That's very hard for people. So when people are stressed at work, it's very hard to come up with that big idea. They tend to have it when they're outside of work. So I will run a series of energizers. When somebody comes into a meeting, they're very stressed. They've read their emails, they've got a deadline, and they're not mentally focused in the room. So I will do something playful just to create a light touch. The moment I hear laughter in the room, I know I've got them metaphorically back in the shower and I can start the session. Another thing that I do is I really enforce the words yes and. And you saw me do the demonstration at San Diego. When people use the yes and rather than, because we all know no because, we all know thousands of reasons why something, but tell people, very clearly signal to your people when you're in an ideation session, we're in an expansive session today. I want you to greenhouse and nurture these ideas with. And if somebody says no because, celebrate them. Get them to stand up and say, I'm a reductionist, and cheer them on, laugh, everybody will applaud, they'll laugh, they'll sit back down, and they'll be expansions. But if you use the words,
I don't have time to think. And so you're going to say then yes and or no because?
I'm going to say yes and. And let me tell you what the reason you say yes and. When somebody throws out an idea, you say yes and because because most of us live in the world of no because. Our experience tells us why something might not work. But if you say yes and, it will invariably make you build on the idea. And when you do the yes and exercise and ask people at the end, did the idea get bigger or smaller? They're going to tell you it got bigger. Here's the crucial point though. When you ask them whose idea was it, you're going to hear them pause and you're going to hear them say our idea. That's huge. The moment you can transfer power of my idea to our idea is the moment you can accelerate its opportunity to actually get done. Creativity is having ideas. And I think that's quite easy. Most of us can have ideas. Getting them done, on the other hand, getting them through all the processes that we have to go through, that's the hard part. But if you use yes and, your idea will become bigger, not smaller. It will become ours, which I think is crucial. It also, your brain can't know because somebody when you say yes and. If you're building on a whole idea around a new golf tournament, you say yes and, your brain can't go to tennis because you're already saying yes and. So it makes you stay focused on the same idea. Another tip that I would offer people is to bring in a naive expert. A naive expert is somebody, the reason I bring them into all my ideation sessions is they play the role of, I call them the naive expert. They will never solve your challenge for you, but they will say something or ask something. They'll ask the provocative question that you're too embarrassed to ask. They'll throw out the audacious idea that you're too embarrassed to throw out. And that idea won't necessarily solve your challenge, but it will get you to think differently. Innovation, as I mentioned earlier, is about getting you out of your river of thinking and thinking a little bit differently. So for example, I brought in a frontline cast member from our call center. We were doing a strategic pricing session, otherwise known as how might we make more money. She's 73 years of age. Her name was Mildred. She did not know what we were working on, but she answers the calls 8 hours a day. And we were just chatting. And I asked her how her day was. She said, I love it. I love coming in for company. I like chatting to people. If it doesn't look like they're going to book, I have to get them off the line and get on to the next call. And I said, well, how many people do you book? And she said, well, for every 20 calls I get, I book one. I said, is that good? Is that bad? I don't know how to think about it. She goes, I reckon I could get 3 or 4 if they would trust me. I said, what do you mean trust you? You're the cutest grandmother on planet Earth, that you've got the name Disney above the door. She said, well, we have this policy called guest request don't suggest. I said, well, what's that? She said, well, if they don't mention the offer that's on the website in some specificity first, I'm not allowed to offer it. And I lose their trust. And I said, ooh, that doesn't sound quite right. So I went off to meet the head of strategic pricing. I said, hey, tell me about guest requests don't suggest. And he said, well, it's worth tens of millions of dollars in incremental revenue. And I said, okay. But I said, Mildred here reckons that if you took her out of her this policy, instead of booking one in every 20 calls, she could book four. I'd like to take her out and her my colleague on a pilot. 6 weeks later, Mildred and her colleagues were booking four out of 20. Guest requests don't suggest went away, and we work it earning considerably more money. Another example, because these naive experts are so important, they might be your frontline employees, by the way. They might be some of your business-to-business partners, by the way. You can bring them in under an NDA. They might be your end users. You bring them in. I brought in a chef to an architectural session, and all the architects looked at me as if I was start raving mad, as if to say, well, what's he doing here? And I said, well, he's very creative. He has to make dishes very quickly if somebody has an allergy or a sauce ingredient is missing or if a plate drops. And he's very creative. He has to make it real in real time. And I asked all of them, I gave them 7 seconds to draw a house. And if I gave your listeners now 7 seconds to draw a house, I already know what it's going to look like by the time they hand it back. It's going to have a triangle on the top called a roof. It's going to have a door at the front and the center and two windows with crosses over them. And you think, why? Because our river of thinking tells us that's what a house should look like. Our river of experience, our river of expertise. Well, the chef had drawn dim sum architecture, which if you've never seen it before, and I hadn't, was a bamboo dish with a pork ball and a steam ball and a little window and a door. Everybody laughed when they turned their pictures around because everybody was identical except his. They realized they stayed in their river of thinking of what architecture should look like. He'd got them out of their river of thinking and considering audacious architecture. Well, if anybody considered audacious architecture, it would be Disney. On the way out of the door, somebody slapped a post-it note over his piece of work and it said, distinctly Disney, authentically Chinese. 7 years later, the strategic brand positioning and guidelines for Shanghai, the construction of Shanghai Disney Resort, distinctly Disney, authentically Chinese. Again, these naive experts will very rarely solve your challenge for you. But they will ask a question or say something that challenges your thinking, gets you out of your river of expertise and to think differently. And that's what these innovation tools are designed to do. Another tool that works extremely well is the use of words. So if I were to ask your audience right now, what should I put in a car wash? I'm sure the first thing I'm going to hear is water, soap, brushes, vacuum, dryer. If, however, I ask them, ooh, I'm going to build an auto spa, what could I put in a spa? I'm going to hear masseuse, barista, wine, wax, robes, aromatherapy. And within 10 seconds, I got them out of their river of thinking of what should go into a car wash and considering the world of possibilities of to what could go into an auto spa. And so Walt was the master of this. Walt used words like nobody's business. So on July 17th, 1955, he created an entire industry, which is still considered the single best example of guest service in any hospitality industry in the world, simply by not calling them Disney employees. They're called Disney cast members. We work on stage, not off stage. We wear a costume, not a uniform. We are cast for a role in the show. And so the custodial host who sweeps the streets feels as important as the executive vice president. Just by re-expressing that custodial host's role as a cast member, he's completely created this industry. A more simple example, but you know, a smaller one, but perhaps maybe more resonant, is I was in a New York office waiting for an appointment about 6 months ago. And I was chatting to this young lady behind the reception desk for about 15 minutes. I went upstairs and I said to the boss, I said, hey, this young lady downstairs, your receptionist, she's the most empathetic, friendly, most wonderful person I've met. I'm going to steal her and take her to Disney. I said, she was your receptionist. He said, oh, we don't have a receptionist. I was like, oh my God, who was I talking to for the last 15 minutes? He said, oh, I said, well, she, her name is Sarah. She had a cream blouse on and a floral skirt. He said, oh, Sarah. He said, yeah, no, she's our director of first impressions. And you literally heard yourself say, shit, I wish I'd thought of that. And all he'd done was re-express her challenge. And by re-expressing the challenge, got her to a completely different place. And I think, again, the use of words in setting up challenges for teams to go work on can be really differential in getting people to think differently.
So speaking of challenges, well, first of all, I'm reminded of your session in Social Media Marketing World, which was, you know, scheduled on the agenda for 90 minutes. And at the end of 90 minutes, I literally had to go up on stage and say, sorry, Duncan, you're out of time. And because you have so much content, you can go on for hours and not just talking, but really engaging your audience as you are right now. Just me, but not just me, but our listener. What I'm going to do is I'm going to forego my usual summary because I want to actually capture that time with one final question. And even though, Duncan, you have said more than two or three times in this conversation that all of this innovation, design thinking, all these principles apply as much to B2B as they do to B2C. I'm going to ask you, I'm going to challenge you, if I may, to really challenge the B2B listener. What can they do differently to get out of that river of thinking? What can they do to think creatively and innovate?
put yourself in the shoes of your end user. Go and spend a day where they live, where they work, what they do. See the challenges that they face. Spend time with your B2B user and find out what the biggest challenges are that they face. Not the challenges that you face, the challenges that they face. And then work an innovation project against that challenge, such as, for us, people don't want to stand in line anymore. And so we had to address it. And so we put ourselves in the shoes of the consumer. We stood in the park. We realized the frustration. So get out of your air-conditioned executive offices. If you've never spent a day, and I mean a full work day, alongside your B2B user, then you don't know what's important to them. And you won't be able to, you may innovate, but it may not be relevant to them because you didn't understand what their biggest pain point.
Kind of like that show, Undercover Boss.
Yes, exactly. That's a brilliant example, actually. That's a really good example. The other thing I think that's extremely important is, for a lot of companies now, they want to innovate, they want to be more creative, but nobody's made it tangible for them. And there's so many courses and workshops that teach at 50,000 feet, and they're very inspirational, motivational. It's about creating a tangible toolkit that normal people can use. Because if you get people using the tools, then you're changing the culture. I would say to people at the end of our workshops, I don't care if people come up and say thank you at the end of the workshop. People are polite, of course they're going to. I take pride when I walk past their office 6 months from now and they're using the tools. That's the day you know you made a difference. And you make a difference by making these tools tangible for people. So by the end of the 1 or 2 day workshops, they know at 9 o'clock tomorrow morning how to use it. And if they start using it tomorrow morning at 9 o'clock, then they'll have the courage to try something else. And so we found at Disney, we created a workbook and most people didn't use it because it was intimidating. So I turned all the tools and behaviors into a set of cards. And now people can take their favorite tool or behavior back to the office with them. They'll use it tomorrow morning at 9 o'clock and they'll suddenly go, oh, wait a minute, I can do this. I'll try another one and another one and another one. And that's when you can change your culture.
Fantastic. Well, Duncan Wardle, this conversation has been everything that I knew it would be and more. Thank you so much for joining me here today on this episode of the Social Business Engine podcast. Where can people find you online, connect with you, and learn more about what you've got going on?
They can find me at duncanwardle.com, which is duncanwardle.com.
And my listener knows that will be linked up in our show notes page at vengreso.com. Duncan, thank you so much.
Thank you very much indeed, Bernie. It's a pleasure to talk to you again.
Well, I hope that you enjoyed my conversation with Duncan Wardle, founder and CEO of Ideate and Innovate, and former VP of Innovation and Creativity at Disney. This has been episode 205, titled, 4 Design Thinking Tools Any Company Can Use to Innovate. Now, I want to share my big takeaway from my conversation with Duncan, and that is that most people struggle with being creative while they're at work. And if you think about it, it's really easy to understand why, given all the demands that people have to attend meetings and respond to a zillion emails and produce reports and just all the distractions. And I love that Duncan points out the power of words and the exercise. And I experienced this exercise firsthand in the mini workshop that I attended at Social Media Marketing World, where I met Duncan. And it's the use of the words yes and. When people are kicking around an idea, just from a brainstorming standpoint, that idea can evolve into something really innovative. And the best part is that in the end, it's not one person's idea. It's really a collective idea, or as Duncan says, our idea. And you know, this whole creative approach to thinking really allows people to get out of their river of thinking, as Duncan says. I love that expression, the river of thinking. So hey, what is your takeaway from my conversation with Duncan Wardle, former VP of Innovation and Creativity at Disney? Leave your comments in the show notes at vengreso.com. Just visit the podcast section and find episode 205. So I want to remind you before we sign off that this episode is sponsored by SAP. Social Business Journal Volume 11 is a case study in savvy social selling the SAP way. This case study is available for download without a form to fill out. Just click on the big button and the PDF case study will open right in your browser, and it's available at vengreso.com/SAP. And of course, that is linked up in our show notes page. While you're there, be sure to subscribe to get the Social Business Engine podcast delivered to your inbox each and every week. And of course, be sure to subscribe to my partner's podcast, Selling with Social, hosted by Vengreso's CEO, Mario Martinez Jr. Well, hey, that is a wrap for episode 205. I want to thank my guest once again, Duncan Wardle, founder and CEO of Ideate and Innovate and former VP of Innovation and Creativity at Disney. I'm Bernie Borges, CMO of Ingresso, signing off for now and wishing you continued success on your social business journey.
Thank you for listening to the Social Business Engine Podcast. Be sure to tune in again next week to reconnect with Bernie Borges for more insights, inspiration, and practical advice on social business. Visit socialbusinessengine.com to catch even more content on social strategy that will rock your business and your career.